When I think of Langston today, I think of a live, work, play community. The residents that live here have a solid sense of community and family. My organization, ACOC, is actually based here in Langston. We provide an array of education support services for children, as well as youth and adult education and family strengthening activities. On any given month, you will have hundreds of individuals that will come to Langston for support services. Langston remains a signature public housing development that's significant not only to Washington, D.C., but with its rich history, it's also a national treasure.
The Langston Dwellings Oral Video History Project has been a labor of love, and it has given the Langston Dwellings summer campers an opportunity to learn, witness, and embrace the importance of the history of their community. They did a fantastic job interviewing past and present residents, taking pictures, and just learning about the rich history of Langston. I just want to congratulate them on a job well done and thank them for their unwavering commitment to the project. Thanks also go out to the ACOC staff, the summer camp staff, the parents, and the residents of Langston. Long live Langston.
I really, really, truly don't want to go anywhere, and I've always told my children, no matter how they try, whatever attitudes they come up, I say until God, get ready for me and call me, because this is a place that I cherish, that I love, and I feel that we here at Langston as residents, we should stick together in love, peace, and understanding, and remember the good days. That's what I can think, and my life is Langston.
Langston Terrace Dwellings is the first federally funded public housing project in the District of Columbia and the second in the United States built for African Americans during the Great Depression. It was built from 1935 to 1938 at a cost of $1,842,000 by the Public Works Administration, or the PWA. It was described by many as a successful demonstration of the possibilities of low-rent housing. The finished project included 274 individual row houses and apartment units. The complex featured a large common area which features a display of a frieze done by sculptor Daniel Olney depicting the progress of the Negro race through a series of bas-relief vignettes. The artwork commemorates the past of the Negro and celebrates the future. The common area also features five large concrete animal sculptures, a frog, a sea lion, a walrus, and two Cubis horses, which were put there as climbing structures for the children to play on and are still standing today. The complex provided affordable housing for working class families. The Langston Terrace Dwellings complex was cited in the Afro-American newspaper on May 29, 1937, as a place where a family of moderate means can live in modern comfort. The Langston Terrace Dwellings was primarily designed and built by African Americans. The chief architect was Hilliard Robinson, a native Washingtonian. Hilliard Robinson and his team included prominent African American architect Paul Revere Williams, African American architect firm McKissick & McKissick, and an African American landscape architect by the name of David Augustus Williston. The labor team was also African American. Hilliard Robinson wanted to create a living space that would include fine buildings and art to inspire and uplift its residents. Robinson's design for the complex included an international style that featured well-designed open spaces and sensitively scaled details. The international styled complex was complete with pathways, sitting benches in front of each residence, and the garden spaces to encourage a sense of community and pride. Langston Terrace Dwellings was placed on the National Register of Historic Places and on the DC Inventory of Historic Sites in 1987.
I didn't know. I thought we were rich. I didn't know we were poor. I had no idea till we moved to River Terrace and somebody said, he's from the projects. And I said, Mama, what are they talking about projects? Mm-hmm. She said, yeah. She said, Langston Terrace was a government assisted living. Mm-hmm. I said, well, what's the difference? She said, well, we were able to save here to buy a house in River Terrace.
Langston Terrace Dwellings was named in honor of John Mercer Langston. He was an abolitionist, a U.S. congressman from Virginia, and the founder of the Howard University Law School. The Frieze, the progress of the Negro race that is located within the common area, features several vignettes. One of the bas-relief vignettes features a likeness of John Mercer Langston pointing to the long road from the South to the opportunities in the North to the male and female sculptures surrounding him. The Langston residents did not have to go far to get the things that they might need. The schools were located within walking distance to the complex. The schools were located in an area called Education Hill, which was the first planned public school campus constructed for African American students. This campus included the following schools: Charles Young Elementary School, constructed in 1931, Hugh M. Brown Junior High School, constructed in 1931, Seth Ledyard Vocational School, constructed in 1931, and Joel Elias Spengarn High School, constructed in 1950. The residents of the newly opened Langston Terrace Dwellings were proud, hard-working citizens. They took pride in the fact that they lived in a community environment where people worked together, looked out for each other, and took pride in their environment and home, inside and out.
Once I moved to Langston, I attended Charles Young in fifth and sixth grade, and then I went to Brown Junior High. It was Brown Junior High at that time, 7th to 9th grade, and then I attended the Dozer High School from 10th through 12th grade.
Charles Young Elementary School, which is now closed, which is really hurtful to a lot of us. We could walk right from these houses in less than 10 minutes to be right in our classrooms. It was very convenient. Everything we shot for was along Benning Road. They were mainly black-owned businesses, shoe repair, dry cleaners, a mom-and-pop store. So everything was very convenient, and the bus, of course, being on Benning Road, and you could ride the bus back then for a nickel. And you got a transfer, you could ride all over town for one nickel. But at any rate, so community was everything to us, our schools. I still remember the police officer that patrolled our neighborhood, Mr. Officer Dixon. And I still remember all of my school teachers' names going back to kindergarten. Ms. Carter, and thank you, Ms. Carter, and Ms. Our principal, Ms. Martha Winston, and the lady who ran our library was Ms. Howard, whose name is altering in this 10th anniversary. But a sense of community was everything. We had a lot of pride here in Langston Terrace. This was the first government project built in the District of Columbia.
It was a family property where everybody in the family communicated with each other. Our children grew up together. They went to church together. They went to school together. I served on different community programs that we had here in Langston that was offered back in the day to benefit our family and our children here in Langston.
Langston, as many early residents lovingly called it, was family-oriented and neighbor-friendly. The residents raised money and collected books to open up a library and recreation center. They planned endless activities for the young residents, had dances, outside concerts in the common area, conducted various craft classes, and showed movies. The famous Billy Eckstein, Count Basie, and the WPA band played in the common area for the residents. Even Roy Rogers and his horse, Trigger, paid a visit to Langston. Langston even had a newsletter called the Langston News.
Excuse me. I live in this house, so I could just look out the window and see if any of my friends were out playing. Mm-hmm. And if I saw anybody, I would come out and we'd play paddle tennis, dodgeball, jump rope, double dutch. We spent a lot of time on the blacktop.
Yeah, I mean, the National Symphony Orchestra right up here on the front. In the movie, they would put a, actually with that second window, the big screen would come down, mm-hmm. or like a big old cloth. And we saw movies. You could sit here and watch the movie. A kid, we would go up front, put little blankets down. Every That's Saturday it. Night for the movie.
Wow.
Nice movie. I'm not talking about no job movies. Nice movies.
The stone, the animals were carved out of stone. We had many activities. We played kickball, dodgeball, volleyball. We had pie eating contests, watermelon eating contests. We had movies shown on the wall. We had, we went swimming. What else did we play? Hopscotch, double dutch. We also had potato sack rat races, and we had dances as well.
Some of the former children who grew up in Langston left and became college graduates, authors, engineers, pediatricians, registered nurses, architects, lawyers, college professors, recreational specialists, and police captains. At one of Langston's reunions, it was mentioned that the children did so well because of the caring attitudes and mentoring they received from the Langston adults who were considered as good role models. The families worked together to build a strong sense of community.
Well, I retired from the D.C. Fire Department, D.C. Fire and Emergency Medical Services Department, and after I did 33 years, I became a deputy fire chief with the D.C. Fire Department before I retired. And I now reside on Branch Avenue, Southeast, in the Hillcrest section of Washington, D.C. So I have stayed here. I've made my home here. I raised my children here. And if it could have been any different, I don't know how, but I'll just say this, it's a wonderful life. And I just thank God and my mother and my father for, and all of the residents here at Langston Terrace who raised me to be the person I am today.
Well, as a writer, I get up in the morning. That's the first thing I think about, what I want to write that day. I try to write every single day. I don't always make it, but it's my intention to do that. Sometimes I go to speak at schools or conferences. But mainly, I'm writing at home. I spend hours and hours writing, making up stories and poems. I love it because I daydream. Excuse me. I daydream a lot. And when I'm daydreaming, I see characters and I hear their voices. And then I put all that together with what I have learned by studying writing. And in the end, I've done a book.
Langston celebrated 75 years in existence on May 5th, 2013. A big celebration was held in the common area of the complex. Some of the original residents who moved in the complex in 1938 participated in the celebration. Many alterations have taken place at Langston over the years, but it still retains much of its architectural integrity and original appearance. The beautiful two-tone brick is still in place. The pathways and individual gardens in front and in back of the residences are still intact. There is even a community garden for residents to utilize. The artwork is still present on the building and on the common area. Swings, sliding boards, jungle gyms, and even a protective surface has been added for the children to play on. Basketball courts were also added to the common area. The original power plant for the complex is still standing. When it was operable, it fueled the complex through the use of coal. It has been inoperable for over 30 years. However, the District of Columbia Housing Authority has planned to redevelop the power plant into a model for renewable energy generation in support of the Sustainable DC initiative. One elementary school, Charles Young Elementary School, and one high school, Joel Elias Spingarn High School, have closed. These schools were within walking distance of Langston. The DC streetcar program is coming to Langston. The H Street Benning Road line will run past Langston Terrace Dwellings with its terminus at Spingarn High School. The trolley car barn, operations base, and maintenance facility will be housed on the grounds of Spingarn High School.
What is different, we didn't have air conditioners. There were no houses on H Street. The Langston Addition was not there. There were row houses, and they were white houses that had a coal stove in the living room. There were benches out on each property. There were benches out in the courtyard, so many benches between each row of houses. There were bushes and shrubberies and flowers and lots of grass.
And that's our little computer lab and library was setting up over there.
Programs such as the Residents Council has been implemented to continually support the Langston residents.
The function of the Resident Council is that we help the residents deal with whatever issues that may come up for them. Say, for instance, if they're having an issue in their apartment unit, we help them get that situated. We help them basically to help them. We are helping them get jobs. We're helping them physically and try to be there for them mentally. The council's future vision is to make it a better, safer place to live and make sure that the people's homes are maintained and that we have a drug-free community.
Langston Terrace Dwellings lives. Its historical value to the city and the Langston community is revered and will never be forgotten.
We are the children of Langston Terrace Dwellings. We are the future of Langston Terrace Dwellings. Long live Langston!
Capable.